The following presentation does not represent Australian opinion or intellect. We do not speak for any religious order or ethnic minority. We are not political scientists or uni graduates. We're insignificant upper lower class scum, comparing notes and airing grievances. It's just our opinion. Deal with it.
So GST will ever be part of our policy.
Never ever.
It's dead.
Go back to where they're from.
It is a big idea.
No, we don't need them.
A new world order. By 1990, no Australian child will be living in poverty.
Right. You should show out.
That's what they say.
Yeah, exactly.
Stuck on freeways. Don't go on Princess Highway because I don't know the roads. I don't use my maps anyway.
I get caught kind of ways, all in the traps. I get loaded. Can't get Google Maps.
Oh wait, good to know.
I'm thinking I might sell my car and get like a VS Club Sport or something.
VS.
Like a manual Club Sport.
Why?
Always want to run.
VS, though. Can you get any good ones now these days?
Yeah, they're getting tough to find.
Getting pretty old.
Even a VX or a VT Club Sport.
You know what? The VXs are alright. The SSs, they're pretty cool. Dude, you can pick up a fucking VY now for like fucking nothing, man.
What are VYs worth?
I'll go on right now.
Yeah, I've had a little look. I really want a Club Sport, though. Like,
Clubby. How much are you looking to spend? Like, in all honesty, like...
Well, I was having a look, and you can get VT, VX around, like, 12-ish.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
What?
And it's cool, because you get, like, it's like a specific build number and stuff. It's just kind of cool.
You're staying in the gully, man.
I was just going to say, yeah, Brad, it sounds like you're just gearing up for the gully specs.
Shut up.
What? I didn't even shut up. I'm being serious. Like, I'm just being honest.
I saw one the other night and I was just like, fuck, I've always wanted one of those. Like, it's a nice manual V8.
Okay, what do those cars drink? Seriously, how much do those cars drink?
I don't know. Probably similar to mine now.
What does your car drink? How many Ks do you get to a full tank?
Depends. It's they're like, the V8s in my car are really good on, like, long trips, but...
No, city. Like, we're talking standard run-of-the-mill.
About 400 in mine.
How big is a tank?
60.
That's a joke.
But, like I said, if I go, like, to sale or something, I'll get, like, close to 600.
How often... You go to sale now out of obligation. You don't always have to get a sale. You're better off buying a fucking Kia Rios or something, man. No, I'm just saying, like...
But the cool thing with those cars is, like, if I get one, it's never really going to depreciate, like...
It's never going to depreciate.
Not if you get, like, a Clubby or something. It'll stay, like...
The Clubby's never going to depreciate. Are you kidding?
From now, not really.
How old's the car?
Like, VSs are starting to go up now, like...
Why would they go up?
Because it's just, like, only made a specific amount, and... You know what I mean? And, like, they just...
But... It's just a... You know what I didn't get about those cars? What year did the VS come out? Do you remember, Nick?
90s,
VS. VS, so VRs were 90... VPs were 93, so VRs were 94 to probably about 95, and they sort of scrapped that, made it better with a VS, so 95 to 97?
That's 98. A 95 car. That's a 20-year-old car. 20 years old. Now, what are the differences between a VT and a VS?
Body shape, that's it.
Other than body shape, interior-wise.
Interior-wise?
Yeah. What are the differences?
VS is probably better.
Okay. But are there any differences? It's
The interior is pretty different.
You think about it, like, from what I remember the VS and the VT to be, it was a pretty stocky interior. Like, it wasn't anything with LED screens like, you know. I was having this conversation yesterday, about how my car, even though it's a 2003 model car, the inside had a DVD player, a sat-nav system, like, and a 6-CD stacker. That was standard. Standard for a 2003 car. Because when the car came out, it was worth, like, 50, 60 Gs. Like, does that make sense?
Mm-hmm.
The VS and the VT, what can you pick them up now, like, for?
What, just the standard VT?
Yeah, standard VS or whatever.
Pick up, like, a grand.
Yeah.
A grand. It's a 20-year-old car that drinks stupid amount of fuel. There's nothing, it looked like a standard Holden compared to all the other Holdens, and it wasn't like it was anything flash. Why the fuck would you buy that car now? It's not like it was a Brocky fucking VL or something where, you know, it's going to be worth millions and it's in mint condition. Like, because I know those are worth a lot of money now.
banned on for him.
Yeah. No, but do you understand? Like, it doesn't make sense to invest in something like that when you've got a fucking Stato now. Why would you go backwards and buy something like that?
Yeah, well, I mean, it doesn't necessarily have to be a VS, but, like, if I got a VX, that'd be the same spec as what my car is now.
Would you spend 20 grand?
Nah. I wouldn't spend that much on a car.
Dude. VX Club Sport R8 Supercharged, top mount, LS112 blower.
Oh.
Top supercharger, full done to the rim.
Yeah, but, like, how many Ks would that thing have on it?
170-something on it.
170,000 Ks on a car that's, like, 20 years old.
Yeah.
But it's not like it was a niche car or
that's a 2002.
Those cars could be cabs for all we know. Like, do you know what I mean? Like, it's not like it's a coupe, like an R31 coupe that's an import. You know what I mean? It's just sort of like a limited thing. It's a standard run-of-the-mill off the factory floor.
Yeah, Club Sports are limited, though. Like, they have each one has this, like, inside the dash. Yeah, yeah. It's got, like, the build number, so it's, like, only a limited amount.
I know what you're saying.
You know what you do, though? Instead of getting a clubby, if you're going to go for, like, a VT or a VX whatever, get a Senator.
Oh, I love Senators.
Dude, yeah, you've got the classy on the outside, but you still got the V8.
Mm. The only thing with Senators, they don't really come in manual, and I kind of want a manual. I'm sick of auto now.
Do you know what it is, man? I think it's because I never saw Holden as that market of a car, like where it's like an import or a fucking sport. It's just, for me, it's just like it's another family car. You know what I mean? Like, like the Commodore, you know what I mean?
Commodore.
Yeah, the Commodore, the Bombador, like the
Clitador. every account's got one.
No, do you know what I mean? Yeah. Like, it's a VT. It's a fucking family car. Like, my uncle could own a VT and take his fucking wife to church every Sunday. Like, deal.
You know what, though? I do remember, because when Con owned the Holden dealership and stuff, he'd bring home whatever he wanted. I remember when the first VEs came out in the ute, and they had the 6-point-something litre VA.
Like, my best mate's got one, VESS.
Dude, he bought it over, and he goes, take it for a drive, and this thing was fucking powerful, man.
Oh, they're fucked up cars.
But I know what you mean. Like, it's kind of like you associate that with a family car. Like,
yeah, really?
Yeah.
It's like, you know, the, do you watch the, like, Bathurst and stuff? Do you watch the V8s?
Yeah, but it's all gone to shit now.
Yeah, remember, like, remember we talked about it, like, on the first fucking podcast, right? You look at the, it's like, dude, they're family cars with big engines just driving around a track. Like, does that make sense? Like, I didn't see it as anything special.
You ever thought about buying yourself a Skyline again? Or something like that?
Toyed with the idea, Troman.
Yeah? Yeah. So I've been seeing a lot of Skylines lately.
I've never had a V8. Always wanted one. Yeah. Manual.
Just to be able to say that you had the V8.
Does it have to be a Holden?
Not just to say it. I just like the feel of driving a manual V8.
Does it have to be a Holden, though? You prefer a Holden?
I really want a clubby. I've always liked them.
Yeah. All right, well,
be prepared to, like, you have to be prepared to take a loss on a car like that, though. Like, the resale value won't be. They've got 170,000 clicks on the clock already.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean? But that's what I'm saying. It's like me buying an R31 again now. I'd love to have one just sitting in the driveway, but I can't afford to buy bread right now.
That's a nice R31. Bread, R31.
No, I'm just, this is poor me, like, thinking, like, my mentality. Do you know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
But you'd have to have it in the driveway as your Sunday driver. You wouldn't be able to use it every day.
Well, I said to Ren, I go, when we buy a bigger house, I'm going to have, like, or my country farm, I'm going to actually I'm going to get a VK shell.
Yep.
VK, and just make it look clean. Nothing flashy, whatever, and just load that engine up like anybody's bitch, man. But I love the VKs, man. I fucking love them.
Yeah. I got a mate that did that with the a Silhouette, like mine. He's just bought it to put it back to stock.
Well, they used to call them sleepers.
Sleepers, yeah, sleeper car. But it looks like stock from the outside. Yeah. It's super clean, just all the original. He had a heart attack. I gave him like my original Nissan headphones. They used to come in the Silhouette. It was Nissan spec headphones.
That's
and
cool.
The front, the grandpa grill for the thing. Gave him all that. He was like losing his mind.
Oh my God.
Yeah. Dude, I said to him, we're at like a family function. We had a function, like a first birthday or something. And then he was talking about it to someone else, like about his car. And then they've said, oh, Tim probably has all that sort of shit. He's like, well, really? Like, yeah. Tim, I'm like, what? Do you still have all your old R31 stuff? Yeah, man, it's in my mom's garage. The guy's eyes just like lit up. Are you serious? What do you got? I'm like, I don't know, 4 Silhouette wheels, the hubcaps. I'm like, yeah, man. He ended up taking me to dinner for it. What do you want for it? I'm like, nothing, man. Can you get a beer or something? I'm just thinking about it now. Fuck, man, where did you park? Did you park on the street where we
just in front
park?
Of you, just in front of you.
Was there heaps of spaces there?
No.
Dude, when I pulled up,
your parking was shit. I had to like weasel my way in because you're like right in the center of two.
No, do you know why?
King Dim.
Do you know why, man?
Well, you should have got here earlier.
Shut up about that.
Plenty of parking.
Shut up about that.
Mr. 1.5 hour late.
Yeah.
Shut up about that.
When I pulled up, there was a woman in like some... Was there a Subi parked across the road? I don't know if you noticed, like a silver Subi.
Didn't notice. I was just in a hurry to get in here.
When I pulled up, she was standing at her car, or holding some picture frame, just standing there at the back door, right? And like she's shutting the doors or whatever. I've pulled up and just pulled up behind her, and I reversed to try and straighten up or whatever. She watched me pull up. I sat there, I took my time, like, you know, turning everything off, and then she watched me, she opened a door, put a picture frame, whatever, back in her car, got back in her car, drove away, did a U-turn, and parked on the other side of the road.
Okay.
Yeah. Like, why? No, I'm serious.
Just cause.
she was out of her car, like, ready to walk away, and she saw me pull up.
And she's like, ooh.
She got back in her car and moved the car to the other side of the road.
Some thug.
I'm not even joking.
He's going to come break into my car.
Dude, I'm not even joking. I got out of, like, I watched.
He's sitting there putting coins in the thing.
Yeah, I watched her get out.
I'm not going to hurt you. It's okay.
I watched her get out and she's standing there. And I just looked at her like, what are you doing?
So you're saying she moved away because she was...
Do you tell me why she would have moved away?
Maybe, I don't know.
She probably thought drive-by.
I'm not even joking. She looks starchy as fuck, like a Jeanette or something. Yeah, like a Susan or a Jeanette. I swear.
She probably thought, I'm just not going to be on the same side of this guy.
I'm not even joking, dude. She got back in her car and moved it to the other side.
Oh, my God.
I'm not that bad. Like, look, clean shave.
His number plate doesn't make sense. It could mean terrorist or something.
Maybe she just thought you were cute and she's trying to get your attention. Like,
the old moving bat, the other side of the road.
The old bat was about to walk away from her car and then got back in her car.
Yeah, because she's like, oh, if I just move now, he'll notice me.
Really?
Maybe he'll come and just drop his number on my lap.
Really?
Drop his number on my lap. Drop something else.
Like what, Nick?
Huh?
Like what?
Like you being late by an hour and a half.
I love how you said I left at 9:30. We meant to be here at 9:30.
Wait, I said 9:30. Between 9:30 and 10, I would have been here at 10, but...
Well, if you said between 9:30 and 10, why don't you just say 10? If you're going to leave at 9:30.
Because you guys always rock up late anyway, so...
I was here at 8:30.
I was
here at like 9:15.
That's rare for Jimmy.
How is it rare for me? Serious? Fuck.
Trying to take the heat off myself.
I like how he's trying to make it less and less. Like, oh, look, it's 9:30 and 10, 10 o'clock. I got here at 11. It's an hour, not an hour and a half. But
sure, fuck it.
No, the traffic, the collision, though. Come on.
Are you kidding? That's what we're going to blame it on, the collision.
Yeah.
Just take Princess Highway, man.
So I bought an e-tag for nothing.
You actually bought an e-tag?
Yeah. Specifically to come here, because it's like...
Really? Mm. What about Eastlink? Don't you use it for that?
I never bought an e-tag for Eastlink. I used to just buy them, like, as I went.
Is that more expensive?
Yeah, it is, actually.
Dude, seriously, just go on Princess Highway.
All right, I'll throw my e-tag out the window when I get in my car and just...
No. It just saves you money, though, because you're paying e-tag and you're paying for parking here.
It's just annoying, because you get an e-tag expecting that to save you time, and then I just...
Yeah, but you'd think it'd save you money as well, but it's not that cheap.
Dude, I'd rather spend an extra 10 minutes on the road than pay $15 for these cunts.
Yeah, I know.
Like, fuck that.
Well, I've said it before about how, like, just the trip into the city is, like, $8 each way or something with the tolls. And initially, like I said, every wog especially doesn't want to spend money on that. Like, they think it's $100. And I used to justify, like, ah, fuck it. I'm going to take the CityLink or whatever. But then, like, you start seeing your credit card.
It adds up, man.
You
got to
buy it in bulk, like, you buy it in increments.
Packs.
Yeah, like, 40. They re-top your thing up. Yeah. Minimum's, like, $40 retop ups?
Yeah.
How many times I've gone into the city for a dinner or something, thinking, yeah, it's fine, I got money on my credit card. I get to the city, go to pay for parking or whatever, and then just look at my credit card balance, it's like minus 45. Yeah. Like, what happened?
And the minimum threshold is like $20, so as soon as you go to $20, it automatically tops it up.
Yeah.
And you can't choose a lower amount, no.
So they're automatically deducting money from you, like, it's like, what are you taking it for?
Yeah. I've still got money in my account.
Jamming the ass for you?
You know what, that's like, man, it's like Fiverr, you know, that outsourcing for media shit that I used, like, to try and get our logo and stuff done.
Yeah.
It works the same way where you buy credit using a credit card or however you want, and then, like, you know, you move it across.
Yeah.
because of like a shit job that got done. Well, I don't think it was even that. I think it's just because I deposited money into the account thinking, yeah, I'll use it. There's still $25 worth of credit sitting there.
You can't take it
back.
I
can't get back.
No, you can't.
That money's going to be sitting there forever. Like, I'm never going to use Fiverr again.
Just donate it to some guy.
I'm serious.
I'd like to pull out my $13 plus out of my...
only way I can think of doing it, honestly, is if I create another fake account. Like, not another fake account. Create a second account.
Send it to yourself.
And send it to myself.
Yeah. Yeah.
Do some work for myself.
Yeah.
That's the only way. Like, I'm just thinking about it now. Yeah, I'm serious.
I'm just thinking about a scam.
Typical Truman.
No, I'm serious. Like, I'm just thinking about it now off the top of my head. That's one way to work. I'd have to pay some sort of fee to Fiverr, obviously.
Yeah, you're going to, like, lose $5 somewhere.
10% or, yeah, whatever it's going to be.
Yeah, yeah.
But that's honestly how I'm going to get it back.
Yeah.
How the fuck am I going to do that?
Get down to the Fiverr offices and give them back my fucking money.
Yeah.
Just walk in there.
They haven't got Fiverr offices. They're like, do you know how many companies are like that? Oh, fuck. What was it? There was another big, big net company that, not net company, but it operates in the same sort of like Uber. Like Uber's offices.
Yeah.
Have you seen Uber's offices?
No.
I was talking to one of the Uber drivers.
Are they Uber?
Yeah. They've got like an office somewhere in the city where they went for training or like to get clearance or something.
Some alleyway.
It's literally just like one room with a desk. Like there's nothing there.
Mm. Welcome to Uber.
What?
And it's got that little hen with the water. You know, the chicken. And the ball thing.
What's that ball thing called?
You know, I have no idea.
That comes off... Isaac Newton's, it's one of his things.
Theory of relativity or something.
Something like that, yeah.
That's all you see on the desk and a piece of paper and a pen.
Yeah, a ballpoint pen.
Welcome to Uber.
Yeah. No, but there's heaps of companies like that now. They're just set up so there's no overheads. Yeah. It's like, yeah, we don't need anyone there. There's physically no one there.
Yeah.
How can you have like a company like Uber with like one desk, one guy?
We could run a multi-million-dollar company from right here.
We could. No one knows.
Yeah.
But that's it. I'm not even joking. You could treat, like, that's the whole point. In today's, like, real estate, in today's, like, all these overheads that would cost money, people just chop it down to absolute bare basics, where it's literally a guy with a laptop.
But that's all you need these days.
Yeah.
That's all you need.
But like, you could easily create the face of a company just by doing that.
Yeah.
You know?
Like when Johnny tells us his invention, I'm sure he'll when he starts his multi-million dollar company.
I know you want my invention to steal.
I don't
it.
Want your fucking invention. I just want to know what it is.
I know you want
to
steal it.
I like how you said the invention was here to help us.
Yeah,
you know
a good way to like protect your invention. How about you patent it, right? Like, just tell us the invention and go and get it, like, copyrighted and
stuff. Yeah.
So no one can take it, because then you can sue. I know what you're going to sue for. I've got nothing.
I've got nothing.
You mentioned net before, and it reminded me. Tell me about your internet, dude. You haven't been wanting to tell me about your NBN.
Oh, the NBN.
Oh, how'd that go?
Is it good or bad?
I left here in a hurry to get home before the techies rocked up, yeah?
Mm-hmm.
They had said to me between 1 to 5.
I got there right? at 7.
No. I got a call. I went to Wavo's to just do quick groceries because we got out of here by 12.
Yeah, you were stressing about not getting there in time or whatever. Yeah,
right. We got out of here by 12 because we were here early that day. We did 3 hours. So it was 12:30 or something, 12:15.
Yeah.
I was in Wavo's at Woolies buying something and I got a call. He's like, oh, yeah, I'm about 15 minutes away. I'm like, 15? Like, it was not even 12:30 yet. Yeah, 15. Yeah. Can you do me a favor and check some connection box or some shit? He asked me to check something. I'm like, yeah, man, no worries. I was sitting there putting bananas in a plastic bag. You know what I mean? Like, I'm like, yeah, I'm checking, you know?
Can you please cut the black wire for us and tell us what happens?
Yeah, literally.
Ooh, the building on fire.
Touch the fuse box with wet fingers. Tell me what happened. I'm like, yeah, all right. I went home, and outside of my door in the building, they've got like a little panel. Like the NBN guys put a little panel in when they ran the wiring from the front of the building to inside the building, yeah? Fucking dumb cunts. They did the dodgiest job. They left these big holes for like 2 weeks. Didn't think to paint like anything. Just left it sawdust everywhere. I'm like, yeah, all right. Called the guy up. I go, listen. I go, there's a little panel box outside of my door. Does that, okay, is that connected to inside your apartment? I go, I've got a fucking idea. All right.
Just call into the wall space for us. And,
yeah. So it comes down. This guy, man, got there before 12. Like, before 1, sorry. So I'm like, okay.
Rare.
Get the chair, gets in, opens the thing up, he goes, right, okay, so the connection's here. Is there one inside your apartment? I'm like, well, no. All right, well, there needs to be. I'm like, what do you want me to do? Okay, this is, I don't know anything. Tell us who's meant to do it or something, apparently. And there were talks in the owner's corporation. Everyone had the same issue. And I said, so what do I do now? He goes, all right, well, you've got to organize for a Sparky to put in a hole and a connection, like, somewhere in your place. So, like, to run it from that box through. Okay, how are you meant to do that? I go, it's a three-story apartment building. Yeah, I don't know.
figure it out.
So it looks like you're just plain old internet still.
Yeah, plain old internet.
Oh, so you don't have it yet.
No, you know what?
Dude, I thought you were connected.
No.
Oh, no, my God. Fucking be in, man.
They gave me another date. I'm like, all right, there's another techie coming out on this day. I'm like, what for? I said, I can't afford to pay for a sparky to come and do it. Then I spoke to someone else who had the same issue in the building, and they said they should be providing that somehow. Like, yeah, lean on your ISP, and they should do it.
Yeah.
I said, well, fuck. And then I cracked it because I called up. Did I tell you what happened with the whole Dodo thing?
No.
When they sent the modem, they didn't send the modem. I said I can go pick up the modem. And remember how they sent me the Cranbourne or whatever, and I cracked it.
Yes.
I found there was a centre in Clayton. I said, all right, I'll go and pick it up one day.
That's where I picked up my Dodo modem from years ago, Clayton.
Yeah. Mm. Dude, that day when I left here, the week before the NBN guy came out, I was on the phone with Dodo from here all the way to my house. It was like a half an hour, 35 minutes. Like, I took a screenshot of the conversation. I was on hold for like 20 minutes. The whole conversation went for like 28.
You got to Clayton before? Like-
yeah, literally, yeah. And I was on the phone asking him, trying to verify, can I pick up that modem from anywhere? Because I can't pick it up from Cranbourne. And like literally, I'm going to ask my supervisor. I'm going to go to the other department. Please hold, please hold, please hold. Half an hour later, I got a, yeah, you can pick it up anywhere. Just tell him the situation. You sure? Yeah, it's fine. It's all right. Dude, the day came to go pick it up. Like, I had my free, like, my day off. I finished work early. I think I finished work early. I'm like, all right, fuck it. I'll go to Clayton because I was going there anyway. I've called them up just trying to verify, just to confirm because I didn't want to start driving around all over town.
Are you sure?
Are you sure? I was on the phone for another half an hour.
Oh, my God.
I was sitting outside. Now I'm just going to get verification from the Clayton depot that you can pick it up. Are you able to pick? I'm sitting outside the Clayton depot. I was in the car park for 15 minutes outside the Clayton depot, another half an hour. Yeah. And they're like, okay, we've never heard of this. Don't know why.
We've never heard
and
of
it was
this.
Like, so you bought it from Cranbourne? I go, you signed up from Cranbourne? No, I didn't. I go, I signed up at Waverley Gardens. What do you mean? There was a pop-up stand at Waverley Gardens Shopping Centre. Where is Waverley Gardens?
No.
So you bought it from Cranbourne and you want to get it from Waverley Gardens? Oh. Like, she just kept going around and I'm like, what are you talking about? I had nothing to do with Cranbourne. Like, I don't know what, like, literally half an hour and then I lost it. And I'm pretty sure it was her that I cracked it at. I think it was her that I cracked it at.
I've
spent an hour on the phone just trying to confirm details that I already knew, and now you're giving me completely random shit. And then after the NBN guy left as well, I think I got another call. I can't remember. It was either her or the next call, one of the two. And I lost it. I'm like, I can't even use this NBN connection, but I know that I paid a connection fee up front, like $160 or whatever, and I'm paying $7 a month extra for NBN when I don't have either of, like, nothing of it.
Yeah, yeah.
Oh, well, what I can do is take, I can drop your account $5 a month, like, for you.
But
like,
I haven't got it. Like, why are you dropping?
So I'm basically paying what I was paying for normal ADSL 2 now.
I want my money back.
Yeah, but I've had to pay $150 connection fee for NBN even though I don't have it. And I may not have it because I can't afford a sparky to come out and putting a hole in.
That seems so wrong.
Yeah.
Have you got NBN down in the gully?
No, not yet.
No?
What's the point?
So what is it? Like, it just makes the internet faster? Is that what it is?
It's different cable.
It's a different grid. It's a different grid, but it's old. That was the whole argument, dude, that the new grid that they're putting in is still old, shitty technology, like copper cabling and not fiber optic stuff. Remember, like, I think Prince Arthur was talking about it?
Because I heard something like, even fucking, like, Romania have better internet than us.
Australia,
yeah, we've got the worst.
Australia's in, if you look it up,
yeah, we're one of the
internet
worst
quality in the across the world. Dude, Sweden, I think it was Sweden or Switzerland, one of those countries, like, 20 years ago, had the best internet. They had, like, fiber optic shit two decades ago.
Man, they're getting their pages bought up without even you pressing anything yet.
No, literally. I'm not even, and considering we're not a developing nation, there's no reason why we have such shitty internet.
Another thing I heard with NBN, like, there's like a standard base one, which most people sign up to because they're not aware that you need to pay a higher rate to get the faster speeds.
Otherwise, you're just getting ADSL 2 speed.
Yeah. So, and they don't really explain that to you. So, if you just go on the base package of NBN, you upgrade for nothing, basically.
Exactly.
And pay more money.
Yeah,
no, exactly, because it's the fine print that people don't realise. It's like, oh, yeah, we've got NBN.
You've got to pay a higher rate to get the faster speeds.
Yeah, exactly.
So stupid.
Oh, they just laugh. Like,
yeah.
So NBN's a crock of shit.
It is. It's dated technology. Mm. Dude, if you look it up, you'll see where Australia sits as far as internet quality. Mm. It's terrible.
It was a big blunder by the government, apparently. Like, they just fucking...
Oh, they just rushed it in, man. They didn't give a fuck. They're trying to get votes, you know what I mean? Like, oh, yeah, we're signing this. We'll be fine. All these fucking fuckwit solutions for shit.
So you don't have it. Dude, I was under the assumption that you actually had it now and you're connected.
No, man, I'd be so happy. I don't even have it yet.
So basically, you shouldn't have to foot the bill for the Sparky, right? That should be your building, because they were meant to...
Yeah, but the building was erected 4 years ago.
Yeah.
And you've got to go through the body corporate and all them to, like, to do it.
Have you sussed out how much it's going to cost for a Sparky to do the thing?
Dude, I nearly had a tooth pulled last week because I couldn't afford to get a cavity filled. Mm. Like, why would I look up for a Sparky to... That's a frivolous expense. Like, I don't need internet. I don't need high speed internet.
Mm. I just pulled up an article. Australia's internet speeds are a global embarrassment.
That's awesome. Exactly. Like, literally a global embarrassment. Yanks come here and they're just frustrated with how slow our internet is. Like, why is it so slow?
Poor game for the most livable city, Dimitri.
It is. Dude, there's more and more shit that we tear apart that makes no sense. Like, dude, do you know how close I came to having my tooth pulled last week?
You were pretty much leaving and saying that you were going to get it pulled out.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I was sitting in the chair, right?
Mirror.
I swear. In my head, I'd already forfeited that tooth. Like, that tooth was gone, right? Like, this is nothing but pain and, like, money. I can't do it. I'm out.
You said goodbye to Old Reliable, basically. You said goodbye.
I didn't even question it. Yeah. It's like, yeah, this is what's going to happen. I sat in the chair, and the dentist, she was like, so, are you okay? Like, you know, is that what you want to do? Like, are you okay with that? I'm like, well, what choice do I have? And she's like, I'm just saying, like, so you came here with it in your head that you're going to lose this tooth. Like, you know, you're comfortable with that. I'm like, well, what do you want me to do? Like, that's what I said. I go, well, what are my options? She's like, okay, A, I can put temporary filling in and I'll clean it up, put the temporary filling in and that'll buy you some time. Yeah, so you can have a think about it. Two, we do the root canal. Or three, we pull a tooth. And I said, okay, well, A, I'm going to have to fucking put a temporary filling's not going to do anything because we'll just be back at square one.
It's just going to be a waste of money.
Yeah, it's a waste of fucking time. Three, I don't have money for a fucking root canal. I go, what's a root canal worth? She goes, oh, between $1,500 to $2,000. I'm like, yeah. I go, I don't have that money. Like, I don't. I actually don't have that money. I can't get it. So what options do I have? She goes, yeah, well, I guess you're right. I'm like, yeah, I am right. So we'll numb you up. Dude, I was literally, like, in the 11th hour, seconds away from getting, like, the tooth pulled. And then just this thing came over me. And I'm like, you know what?
Fuck it, I'm going to keep my tooth. Like, I'm worth keeping my tooth.
You know why, man? In my head, I thought, you know what? I'm paying bills, like, for shit that I'm not even seeing results for. Yeah. You know what I mean? Like, all my body corporate shit. And, like, just, I pay my bills on time, man.
Yeah.
People leave, like, electricity bills for months, like, final notice.
And the lights are...
Yeah, no, like, shit. Literally, dude. People leave bills to the last second. You know what I mean? Literally till they get a note saying, we're coming to your house. So remember this? Some guys are coming.
Yeah.
Literally. Yeah. I try and pay my bills promptly. I put money on my credit card. I put money on the water bill before I put food in my stomach, right? And I've been doing it for fucking since I was a kid.
Just so it's done out of your mind.
Yeah. Yep. Like, it's the right thing to do. I'm like, hang on, man, I'm going to lose a tooth. And it's one of these ones here, like down the bottom where they're like my meat-eating teeth, man. Like, I need them, you know what I mean? Forget steak. I'd have a big fucking gap there.
Yeah.
You know? And I'm like, nah, fuck this, man. Someone can wait. I don't care if it's the electricity company. I don't care if it's the fucking water company.
You know what? They're going to send you out three warnings before they even decide to...
Fuck this.
So you got about a month or two to play with.
Okay. I was actually disgusted. Dude, I was explaining this story to someone at work. I can't remember who it was. Because they'd asked me how I went with my tooth. And I told them that I didn't get it pulled. I kept it, whatever. And I was talking to them about how I was feeling about it. And they're like, yeah, good. You put your body first. You know, like...
Because once it's gone, it's gone. Yeah. Like, that's it.
Like, you put your body first. I'm like, yeah. For the first time in... years. Like, I actually put myself first.
I didn't destroy myself.
Just for the sake of, like, a bank getting another $100.
Yeah, fuck them.
Yeah.
You've always done the fuck them. Yeah.
But that's what shit me. Like, I was actually disgusted with myself that I came that close to losing an adult tooth for $150 to $2,000.
That little guy that's always been with you for all these years, you're just going to dismiss him and...
No, but dude, like, it wasn't even a thought in my head. All I thought was $2,000. Well, I haven't got $2,000. All right, bye.
Mm. Yeah.
Bye.
So long, little fella.
No.
Bye.
Bye. Not even joking, dude. I don't know, man. You've done that, man. Like with the whole holiday thing. We were breaking your balls to go on a holiday, and you still feel bad or guilty about taking a holiday.
Mm.
You're still an idiot. I still maintain that. You should
have gone away, even for a week, just to go somewhere.
Yeah.
Just to break out of that thing.
That's why I'd gone to Malaysia, man, because I cracked. It's like about 3.5 years, but I've been paying my water bills on time every fucking day. Like, come on, man.
Yeah.
It's a joke, dude. And then I started thinking about the whole livable city thing, because more articles were coming up in the paper about, you know, shit hitting the fan and everyone's losing their minds. Dude, there was something on the net. Oh, the morning show this morning when I was getting ready. Did you see
which one? Channel 10 or 9?
The one Koshy's on.
Seven.
Seven?
Sunrise.
No, I just turned the TV on and it was on while I was getting ready. There were these fucking three panelists all giving their, you know,
views.
And they've said something like one in four Australians has got less than $400 in the bank for savings.
Wait, I've actually got $10.99 at the moment.
Dude, I was surprised. I had a 20 in my pocket till this morning, and I bought a coffee and a sandwich with it.
Let me check my internet banking.
Yeah. I've been, dude, my internet, I've got
$10.99.
Thank God.
Right there.
$10.99? All right, I'll do you one better.
It's enough for a 7-Eleven sandwich.
A Slurpee.
Dude. If I get the cheaper
top
sandwich.
Number.
Zero. Zero, zero.
That's so sad.
So what was the stat, one in four?
One in four Australians has got less than $400 in the bank safe.
Well, they're true. It's true.
And I'm like, yeah, I don't doubt that. But these three presenters on TV are talking about it. Like, really? You have less than $400 in the bank?
I doubt that.
Get fucked.
Yeah.
And they're giving their opinions. I could have strangled someone on that panel, man. And they said some genius shit, like...
Just imagine him running on the stage.
That's our stage manager. the second panelist, this woman said something like... This is so fucking dumb. She said that the key to it, maybe... because Koshy brought it up saying, in retaliation, he said, you know, interest rates are an all-time low, inflation's low... Everything's low, but the wage increases have been minimal.
Mm-hmm.
So that's one reason why people are feeling the pinch. This woman said the key to it would be cheaper education to enable people to get higher paying jobs to have a higher income.
Mm-hmm.
Is that the key? Cheaper education? Because everyone's going to get an education and find a high paying job.
No, because not everyone is made for that kind of sector. Like
really?
Say,
Okay, so what about the garbage cleaner or the garbage men?
They actually are on good coin.
Yeah, they're on good coin.
Yeah, they're doing all right.
They didn't have to go to
you need an MR license to be a garbage dude. I looked into it, dude, in 2010.
You go get your truck, you get your MR license and you just become
a garbage. Dude, when this guy was in Afghanistan and I was doing night shift at Visi Board, I was looking at jobs and garbage man was a legitimate career option
because
I was looking at the pay. It wasn't bad.
If you go to K&S or something like that.
Yeah, but
then,
the catch was you needed an MR license. I'd driven trucks before, but trucks without like needing just a regular...
How old were you then when you were looking at that?
2010, 25, so 26. I would have been 25 because I had my 25th birthday in Cyprus.
Because I'm trying to remember, like, when they still, the garbage men still, like, rode on the back of the truck and physically jumped off and grabbed the bin by hand. Because that's all changed now.
Simpsons
all...
again, man. The garbage man can.
And somebody else do it.
Because they've got it pretty easy now. Like, they just sit in there. They don't get out of the truck.
Oh, they've still got runners, though.
They've still got a runner
because
to shuffle the bin.
Because instant kill the Caulfield and stuff, because it's so condensed, they have to bring the bins out.
Yeah. Okay.
There's all cars
there's still the apprentice that gets out.
Yeah.
But there's usually the guy with the bloated gut just sitting there punching levers and...
But I know what you mean. Yeah. A lot of it's automated. Like, he doesn't even have to get out of his...
Yeah, it's just those big forks that come down and grab the
bin. But that's more in suburbia where you are.
Yeah.
As in, because it's wider spaces, people got driveways. Like, at Caulfield, Elstonwick...
There's always someone jumping out.
Yeah.
Yeah, because if the cars are parked there, they've got to bring out the bin, so they bring them out to the road.
Yeah.
And then they put them back. And,
Yeah. Gone are the days where you're just picking up the bin and dumping it into the...
that's gone. They're still doing New York.
Yeah.
And all that.
Yeah.
So they play shtick war.
Yeah, certainly.
30 minutes in.
So, she was saying cheaper education is the key.
Cheaper education is the key because it'll enable people to get better jobs with a better education.
She's going to have to stop her $250 a day ice habit.
She's clearly on crack.
Clearly.
No, but it's like that other fuck with that said, you know, the key to buying a house is to get a high-paying job first.
Okay. So give me a high-paying job and I'll buy a house.
Because that means there's no minimum wage, there's no low unskilled workforce, you know, like that labor workforce, it doesn't exist anymore,
yeah.
Because everyone has a high paying job.
Mm. Everyone's an executive.
Yeah.
Everyone.
Yeah.
It was some other fucking decision. Like, I can't remember what they were talking about. Was
we're now all executives.
Yeah, everyone. Everyone is a white collar.
Yeah, no more blue collar, yeah.
How?
Yeah.
That's not the key to sustainability. The key to sustainability is increase the minimum fucking wage and make shit affordable again. Like,
and blue collar is what makes the world run, because if you haven't got blue collar, you're fucked.
You
what,
need
going to suit's going to change your wiring and your roof.
Dude, there's always going to be a working class, but when you're in the world's most livable city, there's no reason why I need to get a tooth pulled out because I have no fucking options.
Yeah. I was speaking to someone else about it, like the most livable city, like some places don't pay for higher education at all. They've got free medical, all that. Like, so why?
Dude, I'd say Scandinavia is the most livable, like as in Denmark and Switzerland and all that are the most livable countries.
Yeah, like just
because their education is free.
Yeah.
Free to the bone. Like I'm talking like unis, everything.
Yeah.
And they want you, like, and we spoke about this last time.
So what is it about Melbourne that makes, like, what are the factors come in that make it the most livable city that would be?
We've got a couple of parks.
Density? Density, like, as in, like, in the space, in my apartment, let's say, in China, you'd have, like, you know, 30 cunts living in my apartment, as opposed to me just living there.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah, but, like, it's all, it takes in, like, and, parks.
Yeah, and it takes in education,
and
healthcare, like, all that. Like, we've got infrastructure in place to do all that. But at the same time, why am I getting a tooth pulled because I can't afford to have a root canal? Like an adult tooth. Mm. Like I would literally have a fucking gap in my tooth.
And you've worked your whole life.
I haven't stopped, and I always pay my taxes.
I mean, add up all your taxes that you've paid over your whole working, like, wow. And you still have to be, like, scrimp and save to save a tooth in your mouth.
Yeah.
That seems a bit mean.
And that's when I cracked it, because a fucking junkie in Cranbourne or Dufton, six kids, Commo,
go to the local,
rent paid, dude, and we said, you'd have grills for fuck's sake.
They're
taken care of. That's not fucking right.
Mm.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like, see, in your situation, because it's fucking like $2,000 to pull a tooth, I pay private health, but I pay every fortnight, and that rapes me in the ass.
Yeah, what's private health?
I'm paying $125 a fortnight.
Yeah.
So it all adds up. Yes, I get private health where I can get seen and stuff, but I'm still paying it every fortnight, and I'm paying on top.
That's $250 a month, right? Yeah. Times 12.
Yeah.
That would be the cost of a root canal.
And plus I pay an extra 80 or 100 bucks rebate, whatever it is, on top of that.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
So I'm really not getting... I'm just...
You wouldn't be going to the dentist every 2 weeks for a cleaning.
No.
Yeah?
I'm still getting...
They're cleaning you out, but...
I'm still getting rimmed, man.
Yeah.
Like, so either way, you're screwed. Whether you have private health or you don't...
You're still paying for it either way.
Like, there's no way anyone would need $2,000 worth of fucking dental every year. Like, no
I haven't been to the dentist since I was, like, six.
But that's what I said, yeah. And the woman said to me, because I was filling out, you know, one of those clipboards with all the new patient shit. I was sad.
Sex. Yes, please.
It was so sad. And she wrote, when was the last time you went to a dentist? I literally wrote, God knows, like, on the thing. And she started laughing when she was reading the... She just started laughing, like, what's so funny? She's like, oh, you've written God knows. And I'm like, yeah.
I'm serious.
Yeah. She goes, all right, so can you tell me a bit about your history or whatever? I'm like, I go... She goes, well, why don't you sort out the tooth, like, when did this happen? I'm like, filling fell out about a year ago. And she started, she's like, why don't you sort it out? Because I was poor. Like, I literally said it to her. I was poor. She goes, oh, maybe you can see. Oh. And when she was walking me through the steps, she's like, oh, you know, maybe, you know, I can put the temporary filling in. Maybe you can, you know, talk to your mum and dad or something. I just looked at her. I gave her this look. I didn't even say anything. I just gave her this look. And she's like, oh,
don't.
Maybe
don't,
not.
Baby.
Yeah, this is like, oh, maybe not. Okay, yeah. Okay, then maybe I wouldn't be sitting here, like, negotiating the terms of saving a fucking molar.
You don't think I thought of that option, maybe?
Yeah, like, no shit.
Yeah.
Because, like, dude, I've had a tooth pulled up in the top back end of my teeth. But I had that done when I was, like, 13 or 14. And... I had a hole there, but now because I've gotten older, the wisdoms have come out or whatever, the jaw, like, tightens up, and the gap is almost gone. And, you know, like, they always say if you pull a tooth, when your wisdoms or whatever, everything else sort of comes back up, the gap will get smaller, you won't really notice it. Dude, I'm in my 30s now, like, I'm going to lose a fucking tooth and get to, what, 55 with, like, not being able to eat steak anymore because of...
Well, that's the whole thing why I did here. Because I had a tooth, but had a massive hole because I had a filling and it fell out. He goes, look, man, we can pull that out or we can put a filling in there just to save it for a while. I go, just put a filling in there, man, because I can't fucking pull it out right now. He goes, because even with private health, it's still going to cost me $1,100. Even with my private.
Even though you've been paying all that. Yeah.
So, fuck that, man. That's bullshit.
She goes, you're young. She goes, I don't want to pull out this tooth because you are still young. I'm like, well, what do you want me to do? Like, Now, what are my options? I don't have any options. The number is resourceful. You know what I mean? Imagine some poor cunt that had no fucking idea or couldn't hustle. But, like, mate, I'll be scrimping the next, like, month, 2 months. Dude, $2,000 for a fucking tooth, and I might get 6 months out of it. I might get 2 years out of it. Like, I don't know. There's no guarantee on a fucking filling.
No.
You know what I mean?
And how did the root canal go? Did you experience any pain or anything?
No, no. First steps was she goes, first step would be cleaning out the decay.
Yeah.
And, like, cleaning out the hole, like, and stopping the infection. Because if we took an x-ray, oh, that was the other thing. Fuck me. She's like, all right, first thing we're going to do is just clean it up, get an x-ray, so we know what we're dealing with.
They make you stand there with this fucking machine. They
I was in the chair. She goes, oh, you're going to feel a pinch. I go, yeah, I've done all this before.
Put this big lead plate over your groin, please.
That's the Robin Williams line. I'm going to find the Robin Williams line later. Did I tell you about that? It was. I'm pretty sure I would have said it on a podcast ages ago. Robin Williams was talking about. Oh, fuck. He was talking about like a false sense of security or something. Like, I can't remember what he was comparing exactly. I'll find out. I'll bring it up later. But it's like when you go to the dentist and he gives you a lead apron to put over your balls, but he leaves the room and goes behind like a granite wall.
Yeah.
And he's like, you'll be fine.
It's like, why aren't you in here?
Yeah, this guy leaves the house.
runs out.
She's wearing one of those nuclear thermo fucking suits. Like, she's handling nuclear waste. And I'm just lying there with an apron on. Like, really?
You'll be fine.
Why are you dressed like the Michelin man?
And I'm all exposed.
Yeah, man. Yeah. This is what killed me. She goes, all right, we're going to do this. And she goes, I said, we're going to take an x-ray and see what we're dealing with. And as she's clamping the thing in my mouth, automatically my ears pricked up. I'm like, x-ray? They're expensive. Like, straight away.
Another cost? No.
Yeah. I swear to God, that was the first thing. I didn't say anything because I had a mouthful of shit in my... And I'm like, okay. Takes the x-ray. Oh, you see here? This is fucked. La, la, la. I'm like, okay. Okay, so she goes, so what do you want to do?
If you see here, you're completely screwed, see?
Yeah. And then when I asked her, I go, so what's this going to cost, like, all up? Like, after I said, okay, I'll do the root canal, whatever. She pulls up a table of, like, costs. Like, she'd already had it ready to go. Like, we're going to need this.
300
this.
Plus 200 plus
200. And all I could see was, like, 750, 750, 350. And she goes, okay, so see here, we've done the cleaning, and we've taken an x-ray, and we've done this. So that's $300. I'm like, what? Dude, already, I hadn't even had a chance to say anything. I was already had a bill for $300 just for sitting in the chair taking an x-ray.
I told Dimmy, I'll go see the chick at the front desk and sort out your bill. Dimmy runs at the back door, jumps the fence.
Never to be seen again.
So did Demetrius come and pay his bill? Who's Demetrius?
Runs off. They look out there to see the curtain, like, whistling in the wind.
Yeah, the toilet window. Dude, and I just go, like, 6 blocks over to another dentist in the chair. I've got the bib already on my mouth. Yeah, I just need a root canal. Oh, so do we prep? Ah, I've already had the prep work done. Just get started. Get started. The procedure.
Yeah, go see the chick at the front desk. And she'll just over
the take this time, I'm even more dragged up. Yeah. Just stumbling out the back door. And come back in. But that's it. Imagine if I didn't have money on me, like, that morning. I would have been fucked. What do you do? Like, you can't do anything. You can't just say, all right, I'll pay you later.
No, because the bill has to be paid that day. It's not like you can just walk out because you never see them again.
Why is it separate to, like, medical bulk billing? It's like a medical thing. It's like part of your body.
I took a Medicare number, but I don't know why. Because I still paid.
Because it goes on your permanent record.
He's fucked. Yeah.
They've stamped it. Denied.
He's fucked.
Just flashing on the screen.
Do not treat.
He's a train wreck. This guy's a liability.
So your premiums go up.
Yeah, man. Just flashing. I see you got a root canal the other year. Fuck that. We can't help you.
Again with the Simpsons, like when Homer goes to get the car and the computer shuts down.
Siren?
No.
I love that car salesman. He's got that big toothy smile. What a sick ass man. And the cowboy hat. Yeah, it's sad times, man.
Yeah.
I just laughed. I'm like, this is so pathetic. And there's no help. There's no help for me. I don't have kids. I'm not a single parent, you know.
I'm not a Torres Strait Islander. Maybe you should become one.
What,
single parent.
Just adopt a
child. Get benefits.
So it's just like a crazy contrast of like somewhere like Finland or whatever where they look after their people.
Dude.
People make the country work. Like, let's look after them and make sure they're okay.
Yeah, man. Like, we look after our
Like, we're supporting people, the country. We're giving you... I just gave you 20 grand in tax.
Yeah. You know what kills me? It's because we pay super. Yeah, like, every week, we pay super to whatever. It's like, yeah, that money will help my retirement, but at this rate, I'm not going to see my retirement. I'll either be dead.
Why are you laughing at me? It's funny. Sorry.
It's funny.
Like, no, yeah.
My pain and misery is funny.
No, like, yeah, it's just...
No, but at this rate, I'm not going to see my retirement. I'll be dead or fucking living half a shill life. Like... Yeah, that's just me, man. It's, imagine if I had a family. Like, I'd be fucked.
Mm.
Imagine if I had a family, I would be fucked. See, what was I comparing? Oh, do you know what that reminded me of? All week, for some reason, I had it in my head about a root canal, and I didn't know where it was from. Like, why? That phrase, why is it so strong in my memory? And you know what? Simpsons. It finally clicked at me 2 days ago at work.
You remember dental plan.
No. Yeah. Even older.
These braces.
Even older, man. Remember the one where Bart has to repeat the fourth grade? Like, because he didn't know anything about, what was it? Something to do about the Declaration of Independence or something. I can't remember what it was.
Oh, is that because he's sitting at the window? He was trying to study for it?
Yeah, and he keeps getting distracted.
Yeah.
I just discovered a new thing, the sled. John Hancock's writing his name in the snow. Yeah. Do you know what that reminded me of? Where he's like, got the words, repeat the fourth grade ringing in his head, and he's just staring off into space. Flashes to, what was the name of the pirate, the pirate in the book, Treasure Island? Bart Simpson?
Look, lady.
And he's like, look, lady, I got a pep to call, sir. My wife's talking to me for a new car, and I need a root canal. Could you bug me about the stupid pirate?
Yeah. I'm John Silver, Dad.
Yeah. And dude, it came to me, right? And do you know what me further analyzed? Like, hang on a second. This guy's repeating the fourth grade. He's got a son. He's got a wife.
He's got a son and a wife.
He needs a root canal. He's got more than I do.
Look, lady. That's the best part. Look, lady.
Yeah, look, lady. Yeah. He's got a son and a wife. Even I don't have that.
Yeah.
No. Seriously, dude.
Sad times.
Yeah. It's fucked up. I don't know, man. I'm not entirely... I don't know, optimistic about the future.
Mm.
You know, last week when you left and you were saying that shit about...
You're going to mention it next podcast.
Yeah, you were saying about how if your old man had you with someone else, would you be the same person?
Yeah.
Yeah, that started doing my head in over the fucking...
Yeah. Oh, I trip out on it a lot.
What were you actually thinking about? As in, your physical makeup or your personality or what?
My personality.
It'd be different, dude. You grew different DNA.
What do you reckon makes personality? Like, obviously, it's going to be, you know, your surroundings, yeah? Mm. Like, where you're born into and all that sort of shit. But do you reckon it's purely that? Or do you reckon there's got to be something in your blood that you've carried over from, like, a parent or something?
The hard one, man.
Well, you do have character traits from parents, from your environment. Like, for all you know, you could have been born in fucking Kenya and you wouldn't know any different.
Mm.
Do you know what I mean? Would you still be Johnny in Kenya?
Yeah. Do you know why, man? It struck me because I've got a mate. Who's a journalist, yeah? I've got a mate who's a journalist.
Bobby Love! And I know.
You're fucked.
Bobby Mutombo.
Bobby Mutombo comes with a big dick. Come over here, my love.
Fucked, man. I was thinking about it, dude.
Because you've got, like, everyone's got their own body, right? Like, everyone's got a body, like your meat wagon, but everyone has this own, like, your own, like, I see it as like a soul or something, like your life force, and everyone's different. Like,
okay, do you know why I'm bringing it up? Because I thought about a mate of mine who's a journalist, yeah? And he hasn't got a relationship with his old man, right? Like, I don't know how old he was when his old man sort of went away or whatever, but he does not have a relationship with his old man. And I only found out a week or two ago that his old man was a journalist.
It's made up in his DNA.
Do you know what I mean? I had no idea. Like, this mate of mine is a journo, and so, like, he's good at what he does. He's had no relationship with his old man, but his old man is a journalist, or was. Yeah, I don't know what the deal is.
And he wouldn't have known much about his dad.
No.
Like, he would have known.
Like, up until a certain point.
That could just be a coincidence.
Well, what's your dad?
A naturopath.
You mixed in herbs?
I did. I used to chop up my own mixtures of herbs.
Exactly. And used to make people feel good.
This is very true.
Like, no, I'm being serious.
Yeah.
No, like, is it just, do you reckon it's in your DNA? Like, it's unavoidable?
I don't know. That's what I've...
Well, it's like the sons of famous athletes, how they become famous athletes. You know what I mean? Or like they've... Like, you know, you look at Dennis Rodman's kid, I think Jordan's son, some other random, I can't remember who it was. Like, their kids are all, like, becoming... On their way to Shaquille O'Neal's sons.
But a lot of them is also a product of their environment. So they grew up watching their dad play basketball.
Yeah.
So it's like, maybe I can try and play basketball as well. And they get the best training because their father was an NBA athlete.
All right, well, you know what? It's like Gablet. Yeah?
Good old Gablet. Yeah, that's in the DNA, mate.
Gablet. Do you reckon Gablet would still be a good footballer if it wasn't for his old man?
I think so.
Or do you reckon it's in his DNA because his old man was God on the football field?
Yeah, good question.
All right, Gablet and Gablet Senior, but look at Nathan.
Yeah, Nathan was a good footballer.
Great. They reckon Nathan was better than Gablet. Yeah, but it was just he had the same scrutiny. Personality as his father.
Yeah.
He goes, I don't want... Because Gary Ablett hated the media and stuff.
Yeah.
And Nathan was the same. Came to Geelong, played like 3 years, won a premiership and fucked off.
Yeah.
No one's ever seen him again.
He went up north.
he went to go do building. Yeah,
became a tradie in Morningside or some shit.
Yeah.
Yeah, like just didn't want the spotlight. Like, fuck this. But again... Is that it's in his DNA?
Well, it's like Silvani, this Jack Silvani,
and the grandfather.
And his, well, that's three generations of footballers. Yeah?
And now Ben's coming through as well.
Yeah. Do you reckon it's in the DNA, or do you reckon it's because they were in the football environment that just enabled them to become good footballers?
Well, that's right. Because if Serge never picked up a footy, they wouldn't have become footballers.
Or probably, less likely
to become a footballer.
Less likely, yeah.
Like so, like fucking Stephen could have run the fucking Carlton crew in fucking Lygon Street. Who knows? You know what I mean? Like, who knows?
And the kids could just be gangsters.
Yeah, man. Mm. You know what I mean? Jack could have been a smackhead. Look, who knows?
Yeah, but who knows? But that's what I'm saying. Where at what point is it...
But it's like, it's the guy's sperm, right? Like, is like the moment he shoots it out, is that destined to be you? Like, no matter who it goes into? Or do you just change depending on what room...
Who you become is always going to be up to you. Well, not always up to you, but it's just, like, I think that environment plays a big part in it. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
I think your physical genetic makeup may enable you to be able, like, look, man, I mean, you look at me, right? I'm average height, average build. I'm not super tall or, fuck, I'm not, like, the size of a jockey, but I could never be a power lifter in Ukraine, you know, breaking records of fucking weightlifting 8 sizes up my weight class because that's just who I am.
Yeah.
Like, does that make sense?
Yeah.
Like, that's never going to change. It's like, okay, you know, it's like The Rock, Dwayne Johnson, yeah? His old man was
a wrestler.
A wrestler.
Yeah.
And he's a unit of a dude. Like, even, like, now, like, he's old.
Superfly
or whatever, right?
Yeah, something like that.
No, his name was Rocky Johnson.
Rocky Johnson. Oh, okay. That's right. I looked him up the other day.
The Rock's first wrestling name, Rocky Maivia, was a appropriation of Rocky Johnson and his grandfather from his mother's side.
Dude, that's The Rock's dad. He's a fucking unit. He's a fucking unit.
Yeah. Yeah. Rocky Johnson was a massive dude, and he was one of the first to be on camera back in the wrestling heyday of, like, the 60s and stuff. African-Americans especially, they were, like, sort of gimmicks or caricatures. Like, they were forced to do, like, a lot of demeaning shit just for the character and on camera. Rocky Johnson was, like, one of the first to have, like, a personality and have, like, charisma and not have to do
break away from that gimmicky...
Not from the gimmicky crap.
And then you look at The Rock's the way he's made up.
And his maternal side, he's Samoan, right? Yeah. Like, Polynesians.
Yeah.
And his grandfather was the great fucking wrestler, the Maivia wrestler, right? Yeah. And they're all family of fucking wrestlers. So, genetically... He was going to be gifted with this, like, fucking physique.
Yeah.
Like, does that make sense?
He didn't have to go to wrestling. He played football.
Mm.
Yeah. As in NFL.
Yeah, he got drafted to Canada. He played Canadian football for a couple of years, and then in the end, like, that was going nowhere. So he said, he got injuries.
Mm.
So he said, fuck this, and he really wanted to do wrestling.
Mm-hmm.
But that's because he grew up in the ring. Like Bret Hart, yeah? Bret Hart was
good
a
product. Good old
hitman. Yeah. The best there is, the best there was, the best there ever will be, man. He was a product of his environment. Because him and his brothers, they grew up in Stu Hart's fucking wrestling dungeon. Like, that's what it was called, the dungeon. Stu Hart was, like, a notorious wrestling trainer in the 50s, 60s, and 70s.
They were going to be wrestlers.
Yeah. They were going to be wrestlers.
Mm-hmm.
So they would have the genetics of, like, being, like, that frame of body or whatever.
Mm. But it doesn't always work out that way, right?
Well, no. That's
like,
the thing.
You can Andrew Bogut, like, his parents are both, like, just... And average. He used towers over both of them.
Yeah. That's a lot of people. That's a lot
Do you remember
people.
Harold and Kumar at all? Like the movie.
Yeah, I love that movie.
Yeah. Do you remember at the start when he's sitting down for an interview for an internship
or
something, and he's like, you know, but you got perfect SAT scores or whatever, you got perfect this and that. Why don't you go into medicine? He's like, just because you're hung like a moose doesn't mean you have to do porn.
Yeah.
It's like, why would you not do it?
Yeah.
And it's like Kyrgios and Tomic as well. Like, Kyrgios has said it openly, he's bored with tennis. Tomic has openly said he doesn't like his fucking job. He's just treating it like a job. Just because you're blessed with those genetics doesn't mean you have to fucking pursue it.
Mm.
You know?
But how often as well do, like, someone have two kids and the kids are complete polar opposites of each other?
Oh, so that's because it could have taken some from the other side, could have taken some from your side. You know, and again, the kid also grows up with his own ideas, own ideals, and everything.
Okay, well, look at this. I'm a twin, yeah? Nick knows my sister and me both, like, pretty well, right? How alike do you think my sister and I are?
Not very.
And honestly...
Chalk and cheese.
Chalk and cheese. Chalk and cheese.
Under an hour. They just squeeze both in. Under an hour. You can't.
Like... Like, they're... since year seven. From both of them. And they're just two totally different people.
Mm.
Like, yeah, it's actually amazing to see Dim and his sister.
I know that I share mannerisms and
different things.
Like, grew up in the same house.
There might be like a little bit in the laugh or the way they react, but
in the same sense, Nick and I share mannerisms because we grew up in the same fucking house as well, from year seven.
Yeah.
So we're going to share mannerisms and shit. But as far as personality goes,
no, nothing at all. They're two totally different. Like, if you put his sister and Dim in the same room, and you didn't know they were siblings, twins, you wouldn't even think, like, it's just not a... Yeah.
So, which brings me back to the point, if it's a different room that you're into, would you still be you? Like, would you still have
Well, you can't answer that. How you
I think... Look, you've got to think of it, like, by stepping outside the box. Do you know what I mean? I don't think you is a clear-cut, definitive thing from at any point, because you could always change.
You can change yourself right now.
Dude, I could have made a lot of...
But my awareness, like, I don't know.
Yeah, no. The way you think, everything, la, la, la.
Like, would Kenyan Bobby still smoke weed? I'm just saying, like...
He would.
He would. He'd smoke the ganja.
He's Jamaican. Kenyan Bobby would be Jamaican. Yeah.
It's the last of Bobby.
Nah. I think you're...
I should get dreadies.
You should.
Why?
Yeah, man.
I saw someone with dreadies at work the other day. In the back of my head, all I was thinking was, cut your fucking hair. They stink. You know dreadies stink?
Mm.
You get dreadies by not washing your hair. Mm. Like, that's how dreadies come.
Yeah, you're not allowed to wash.
you don't wash your hair. That's filthy.
Bobby would hate that because he wouldn't be able to have his lavender bath or anything.
Exactly. I'd have to, like, put it into some sort of, like, shower cap bun.
Dude, dreadies stink. Like, they fucking reek.
It's pretty gross.
It's disgusting. I can't.
Yeah. He likes them, though. Look at him.
He wants that shark tooth necklace around his neck as well. Or that shellfish shit.
See, you could become a surfer.
Yeah. Yeah, out in Rover when they build a beach.
Yeah. Oh! Number one surfer in Rover.
Rocks up in his clubby with the...
Step aside, ladies.
Surf's up, dude. Dude, it's a man-made lake.
Oh, man, it's Johnny Wright.
Heard about him.
He's like a legend around these parts.
Hang on.
He doesn't even surf, though. He just leans on his bonnet and, like, has, like, water. Just like... Just rocks up. Yeah, man.
Hey, this is 28 days, right?
Yeah.
28 days. So mad.
They're touring.
Yeah, I know. That was one of my first concerts when I was 16.
Are you serious?
Yeah. In Croydon. EVs in Croydon. Shit, I saw 28 dude. Days.
What a song!
Do you remember EVs?
EVs?
EVs in Croydon?
No.
What the fuck is EVs?
It was like where they had bands like 28 Days.
No, I remember the place we went to in Ringwood. What was that called?
Oh, Whip.
So that was
Whip. That's what you're thinking of.
Yeah.
Orange Whip or whatever.
Yeah, we used to go down there in carloads, man. Like, just
I don't remember EVs. I remember the other one out in at the gully at the
Middle Hotel.
Rubies.
Oh, Rubies. That's up Belgrave.
Oh, sorry.
Yeah, but we would watch bands and stuff there. Like, is that what it is?
The Middle Hotel.
Is that what it is? Mm. They used to have bands. I went and saw Butterfly Effect and shit.
Yeah, I was seeing Grinspoon there. Butterfly. Yeah, I was probably there when you saw Butterfly Effect.
And then saw his new band when he came out with Thousand Needles in Red. That was pretty cool. Mm.
Thousand Needles in Red.
Clint Boge.
Oh my god.
Yeah.
Sick voice.
Yeah.
I like Butterfly Effect.
He could have done more with that band, man.
Yeah.
Heck.
I remember they were big in like 2005 or something. Like, is that what I'm?
They were bigger in the States than they were here.
Yeah, but that's every band.
And then they just disintegrated, man. Like, fucking...
Yeah, just went nowhere.
They were really good, man.
They were really good.
What were they? I remember at one point everyone was talking about them.
Like a...
Very weird sort of...
Rock grunge kind of...
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Grungy sort
but
of...
But they did have some heavy riffs, but it was really... I can't explain it. It's just really weird. But it was really cool.
They kind of had like a bit of a Tool feel to them, like with their film clips and stuff as well. Like that sort of,
They kind of had a little bit of a dark film clip sometimes.
Every time someone says a band that's like left off center like that and struggles to find a way to describe them, I just think of Jared Leto's fucking band. What are they called?
30 Seconds to Mars.
I was talking about them last night.
Were you?
Because we were saying how he...
That's like my go-to for weird, like non-conformist.
You know what though? That guy's a talented dude, man.
Yeah.
I'll give him that. Like he's pretty cool. Like he's actually like, you know... Did the acting thing. Yeah.
So what we were...
Start a band.
What we were saying about him is there's this documentary where it's basically them talking about how they were in debt to their record company and they're just like trying to sue them and they lost the case and they lost heaps of money and stuff.
Yeah. They lost... As in, they lost money to their record label.
Yeah, like you know how big 30 Seconds to Mars were. Like they're on video hits. Huge. They never made any money. It was through Virgin, like when they were going under or something and they just basically were in debt.
How could they never make any money?
Maybe that's why the bass player left to Angels and Airwaves.
Maybe.
That Blink throwaway band.
Yeah.
The throwaway
band. The guy from 30 Seconds to Mars went to Angels and Airwaves.
Fucking hell, man. They're so incestuous, like all the...
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean?
Yeah. Everyone's been into... Like,
yeah, all... it's strange. Like, you think about that. Like, it's not strange, because it makes sense. It's like, you know, like In Flames, all those bands were... Like, all the... German, Swedish, Finnish bands, they're all made up of the same musicians from, like, every other band.
Dude, I've been getting into Ghost so hard, man. Did you get...
No, I didn't hear anything.
Dude, let me play you just a sample of this track.
I've actually listened to a bit of Ghost, so I probably would have heard it.
Dude, so cool, man. Like,
the
concept is Sweden.
Nah, of course.
But, you know what?
And they only revealed their identities this year.
Well, not only because the band members sued...
And
he's like, you guys were never part of, as in, because it was a solo project. He started as a solo. And it was, they were more like studio artists.
Studio musicians, yeah.
But I kind of see where he's coming from.
Okay, so what's the whole issue? Yeah, look, I think I remember now Ghost, someone had told me about him like ages ago, and they wore masks or something.
Yeah.
Or you never saw who they were.
Yeah, the singer's Papa
Emeritus. Yeah, and there's been three of them, like the first, the second, and the third.
And then, same singer.
And then the other guys were the Faceless Ghouls.
Okay, so they just took identities on in the band.
Yeah, so the band members, the singer had an actual... He was Papa Emeritus, whatever.
He was described as like a demonic pope. He'd have like the
anti-pope.
Anti-pope.
He'd so have
like
cool, man.
Like, full get up, like this crazy face paint, and you couldn't tell who he was.
Yeah.
And then the five ghouls.
Yeah. He's actually got a cool name, man. Tobias Forge. Fucking sick gun. But
he
didn't give his bandmates names. They're the nameless ghouls. As in, like, do you know what I mean? Like, they weren't like...
You're just faceless. My ghouls.
Yeah. Just faceless ghouls. Like, that's
how often did the band members change? Like, the...
I think they had a couple of lineup changes and stuff like that.
But the lead singer changed?
No, he just changed personality.
Oh, so his persona changed.
Yeah, I'm just trying to know anything about him. Yeah, yeah. And
so what happened?
They came out this year saying he owed them money and stuff like that, and they revealed who they were. Like, fuck ya. Well, fucking...
And then they said who he was as well.
Yeah, Tobias Forge, yeah. But he went and got new bandmates, and they're touring. So it's like, well...
Oh, so you got rid of all of them?
Yeah, yeah, fuck you.
Fuck off, ghouls. Getting ourselves some new ghouls.
They're dressed up as ghouls again, but they're just new bandmates. But,
That's harsh.
But
that's not harsh, it's like a fuck you.
Very Sabbath-y.
Doom metal,
yeah.
You'll love the riff, the small riff that's in here.
That sort of melodic, dark sort of, yeah.
Yeah, that's...
But it's all clean. All clean.
I think Dave Grohl had a little bit to do with him as well.
Of course he did.
He filled in for one of the members. This riff coming up, See, it's different.
That's cool.
It's kind of New Age Sabbath-y, in a way, the music side.
It's like a mix between grunge and metal. Yeah. I'm feeling like... All the old shit. Do you know what this sounds like? This sounds like if Kurt Cobain and Tony Iommi like made a band together.
Yeah, man, yeah.
From Sabbath.
It's just... These guys are cool as, man. Do you know what I mean? It's got that cool, like...
Yeah.
But they do some different shit, too. Like, they've got, like... not, I want to say poppy tracks, but you know what I'm talking about. Yeah. Like, look into them, man. They're pretty cool, man.
Fucking hell.
And their film clips are quite, like, dark.
Yeah.
They got this other one that came out, Sir Ice, which is sick, man. Like, it's...
Dude, when you said doom metal, I just fucking flash back to being, like, 19 and on the net, reading about bands on forums and stuff, and all these, like, purists, you know what I mean?
That's doom metal.
Yeah. You're not goth, like, this is goth.
Yeah.
You're not fucking sludge metal, this is fucking grind metal. Like, what are you talking about?
Yeah. Like, I didn't even know fucking... Johnny said yesterday, doom metal, and I'm like, the fuck? Like, I just like the band. Okay. The actual music.
How do you feel about that sort of shit? Like...
It annoys me.
What part of it annoys you?
Because there's so many, like, little sub-genres, and it's, like, people, like, are so, like, snobbish about it. Like, that's our little, like, you know.
Like, purists and shit like that.
Like, I know if you go to Scandinavia, you're going to get death metal, black metal. Yeah?
Yeah.
But that's... When you hear that, you know there's a fucking difference.
Yeah, but
like, doom metal and all that, I don't understand
people, but that's the thing. There's technical metal, there's, like... If you look up metal, there'll be a million genres. There's power metal, there's speed metal, there's... Yeah, okay, look at this right here. It's...
Thrash.
It's sort of like... Okay, there's good things and there's bad things about it, right?
Post-hardcore.
What's that?
Post-hardcore crossover.
It's like the shit that I was into, like stuff like Amity Affliction and stuff. Oh, yeah.
Post-hardcore
stuff. You've got Screaming and Cleans, like those real like soft sort of Cleans.
Yeah. One Last Night, Our Last Night is sort of like post-hardcore as well, man. Like, hang on. Actually, where's my iPod? I can just get my iPod. Just give me a second.
So would you, like Killswitch, would they be metalcore?
Yeah. Yes. Yeah,
metalcore. So they're metalcore.
Yeah.
Okay, so bands like Killswitch, like Parkway Drive, they're all metalcore.
Metalcore.
They're straight metalcore.
Straight metalcore, okay.
Yeah.
All right, cool.
Killswitch.
Okay, do you want to remember? Do you remember when we used to go to Red Moon in the city?
Yeah.
Do you ever go to Red Moon?
No. Rental Metal Club.
What are they called? What was it?
Insignia.
Ragnarok or whatever.
Ragnarok. Ragnarok, yeah.
Yeah.
Full Metal Club.
Yeah, Full Metal Club. Mate of ours used to run the nights there, Red Moon down in King Street, yeah?
I went to Goo once.
Nah,
Goo.
We went.
I've been to Goo. Didn't we go here once?
Yeah.
Was it that?
Yeah,
that night.
You've got like the club down the bottom, and then at the top there's this like metal room or the metal heads.
We got into a brawl. Some guy's missus was checking one of our crew out. I don't know who it was.
Yeah.
And then the guy like started cracking it. Like, dude, we didn't do anything. And then Sharan was there.
The boxer.
Dude, we had Hucky the Turk and his brother. Dude, the two nuttiest Turks you've ever met in your life.
And they're trying. These guys trying to get a fight with us.
These guys. Get into a brawl in Clayton with Greeks, and then they turn and fight each other because someone pissed the other person off. So we were sitting there laughing because I'm like, this is going to go down smoothly. Man.
Yeah, we're fine.
Sharad was there as well, the boxer.
Sharad's a boxer.
Just like,
pro boxer.
I was standing next to him. I'm like, dude, what's going to happen? He's like, just give it another minute, man. He's just like, you know, like,
tensing up.
Pre-fight, like, just tense up.
We were fine, mate.
I remember that.
And these cunts are trying to, yeah, no.
Yeah, no.
Goo. Huh?
Yeah, man.
That was good. That was a good night.
Hang on. I fucking hate iPods. I don't even know how this thing works, dude. I use it like once a year, like this. You know what I mean? Was I even pulling this out to play? Oh, yeah. Look, Killswitch, like classic metalcore.
Yeah.
Like that's all they are, right? Like that's how they've always been.
Which are great live.
And the reason why I brought up that night at Ragnarok Red Moon was when my mate was telling me about it, like, selling me the night. He's like, you know, come down, la, la, la. And I said, oh, what do you play? He's like, oh, look, man, honestly, it's just, like, once we got there early, and they had, like, I remember hearing Shotgun Blues by Guns N' Roses.
Yeah.
I'm like, that's sick! Like, all, like, sort of random rock. But then after a certain hour...
Well, as the night got later, it got darker.
Yeah.
The music got real dark.
Like,
they had, like, a lot of, like, Scandinavian death metal and fucking...
Mm-hmm.
They had the Greek band Rotting Christ and, shit, man, Septic Flesh, all these kind of bands that I listen to. There's some cool songs in there, but I'm not like, fuck. Like,
yeah.
Yeah.
Like, it's a bit much sometimes.
He said to me, and I asked him what kind of bands, and he said, oh, Killswitch is going to be the most commercial thing you're going to hear. And at that point, I didn't know who Killswitch were. Like, I'd heard one or two tracks maybe, and I'm like, oh, okay. But even he was talking down as in, like, that was the weakest shit you're going to hear.
Yeah.
Killswitch is still a metalcore band. Like, it's still metal.
Yeah.
If you played that to anyone else, your mum, you know what I mean?
What the hell is this noise?
What the hell is this noise?
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And that, I was not a purist, but because I was in those circles of all these European metalheads, I used to think that the only forms of metal that were worth listening to was
that.
Doom metal and beyond. You know what I mean? Like black metal. Like black metal. Dude, compare black metal with doom metal. Compare...
slight changes.
Yeah, dude, they're like tiny little, sometimes like there's a difference, and as a musician, and
but it's also what the band wants to label themselves as.
But it's like hip hop, dude. Like, you know, people call Eminem rap, you know, and then people say he's not because he's commercial, you know what I mean? Like all his early shit. Like, all his stuff, you know when he sort
He's a lyricist.
You know when Eminem blew up and became Eminem, right? So, the Purple Pills, D12 era, like, all that sort of shit. People looked, purists in hip-hop, especially, like, from the States, would look at him as if he was, like, a joke. Not a joke, but it was just this bubblegum element. When you listen to, like, the Slim Shady LP and all the dark stuff that was just... And he came from a background of battle rapping and shit like that. That was the real elements of hip-hop.
Yeah, yeah.
You know what I mean? Whereas, you know, you could talk to your teenage girlfriend and be like, oh, what do you listen to? I like rap. Like, who? And she names Nelly as rap.
Yeah.
Dude, country grammar album to Eminem Slim Shady LP. Like, come on.
Massive man. Difference.
Chalk and fucking cheese.
Chalk and cheese. He's used it.
Yeah. Right? Like,
clearly. You can use it. It's fine.
But then there's forms of rap, you know? Like, there's... Dude, you compare, you know, Mobb Deep... You know, Prodigy, who passed away not long ago. Like, Shook Ones, you know when you came
in this morning? Yeah,
hang on, fuck, I'm going to go back.
Ain't no such thing as halfway crooks.
Yeah. Hang on.
Yeah, I know Prodigy.
Dude, that track...
I do.
That's such a good track, man. Like, everyone recognises this track as...
Oh, the killers and the
it's
hundred
the It's the battle... The last battle instrumental that they use in 8 Mile? Remember the battle? The last
He doesn't know what
battle?
We're talking about.
Yeah, I do. I am skinny. I did grow up in a trailer park, y'all.
I am skinny.
30 seconds, I don't know.
Still one of the most recognizable beats ever.
Yeah. To all the killers
it's
and the
$100 billers.
For real, because who ain't got no feelings. Feelings.
This video kicks in.
Check it out now.
Oh, this reminds me of driving around the gully stone.
We be the infamous, you heard of us. Official Queensbridge murderers. Right? Dude, you can call that hip-hop. And as far as I'm concerned, that is straight hip-hop. That is like New York, Eastern, East Coast, yeah, straight grime, you know what I mean? Like, that's what the roots of hip-hop are, right? But then you compare, like, West Coast music, right? Where West Coast were doing a lot of party rap and they were gangster rap. West Coast was the first one to do gangster rap. So when Tupac came out, Eazy-E, NWA, Ice Cube, like all that shit. Then the West Coast era, like the Death Row days, Daz, Corrupt, that was gangster rap, right? That wasn't hip hop. Because they say that hip hop, the emphasis is on lyricism and technique. You know what I mean? And wordplay and interesting puns and all that sort of shit, yeah?
Mm-hmm.
Whereas gangster rap was more just about the message and the attitude.
Straight
out,
I want to put a bullet to your temple.
Like, you know, getting the message out, but you know, it was more just about just the delivery and the rawness and the hardness. You know what I mean? So you and then you'd start the whole thing. What's hip-hop? What's rap? What's gangster rap? What's flow rap?
Ice Cube, man. I started this gangster shit.
Yeah.
And this is the motherfucking thanks I get.
Hello.
Drake, yeah. You know, like...
Oh, I was listening to that in Malaysia. I was on the beach. I was in the
what
water.
A track.
How does the beat go? Fuck, hang on a second.
You know what's my favorite, though? My favorite track. Natural Born Killers, man.
Oh, with
Ice Cube and... Wait, who was it? Was it Puck?
Natural Born Killers. Drain. And Ice Cube.
Yeah, dude. Like... What a track.
Hang on. How the fuck does this...
I can't hang around my mama because I scare her.
That's mad.
I'm a bad motherfucker. Hell yeah.
What was that track called? I started this... Fuck, what's the actual song?
Hello.
Hello, that's it.
Hello. I started this gangster shit.
Fuck.
And it's the motherfucking thanks I get.
I hate iPods, man.
The motherfucking world is a ghetto. What a track.
Full of magazines, full clips, and heavy metal when the smoke settles.
Ice Cube, man.
Hang on.
Did you guys get into a little bit of rap in the gully? Like, as in, like, school and stuff?
No.
No, so you're not at all?
No. It was all just, like, skate punk.
Yeah.
This is, I was beatboxing.
Now, this is gangster rap, yeah? I'd classify this as gangster rap.
I started this gangster shit. And it's the motherfucking thanks I get. Hello. I started this gangster shit. And it's the motherfucking thanks I get. Hello. The motherfucking world is a ghetto. Full of magazines.
heavy metal. So this was a staple in Clayton house parties. Shit like this.
Dr. Drake.
Hello.
You sitting there hating? Your bitch is hyperventilating. Fucking we penetrating.
Like, this was a staple for us growing up. Our area, when we grew up, I would say 90% of it was gangster rap, not hip-hop.
911 emergency. It's my son. He's hurting me. And he's a
felon.
You know what's funny? Like, I brought this up because I was looking for one track, man.
But you know what I mean? Like, that's the difference. Like, if you went to Glen Waverley, you could probably hear more hip-hop and stuff like that. Clayton was more gangster rap.
Yeah.
It was different.
The whole point of me bringing this out was explaining what post-hardcore was, and I always think of this one band, man. Symptoms of a Failing System by Our Last Night.
Yeah, post-hardcore all the way. Straight away, you can just hear it. I was big into this sort of stuff.
Dude. I love when the riff kicks in. Straight up. But you know what? You play this to a purist, and they're like, oh, that's...
What is this shit?
That's crossover. Or that's hardcore. Or that's fucking emo. Or that's... You move a million things. But you play it to, you know, my sister... That's just metal.
Just heavy metal.
Yeah, that's heavy metal.
Yeah.
Dude, Ozzy Osbourne is heavy metal. This is not heavy metal.
Yeah.
Listen to him.
Yeah. You have to have those girly clean vocals for post-hardcore.
Like this band Periphery?
Oh, dude, this kid, you know how old this kid was? Get on your phone. This album came out, right? The band is called Our Last Night, yeah?
Mm-hmm.
Take a look and tell me how old the lead singer was when they made the album. You'll lose it. I'm serious.
They've got the same writing as Parkway Drive.
Oh, yeah.
On their album. The same kind of thing.
Just a bit softer.
Just a bit softer. I'm guessing it's Trevor. Is it a singer?
Trevor.
Oh, I don't know, dude.
But all those post-hardcore bands, Jim, they all sound so similar.
Oh, dude.
Like, that clean voice, it's just such a staple for post-hardcore.
You could take one song from all their albums and put it on a best of, and everyone would think it's the same exact band. Yeah.
It sounded like Silverstein to me straight away. That was another band.
That's what I'm saying, dude.
Well, okay. So Trevor Wentworth is the singer, right?
Yeah.
They've been going since 2004, right?
Which is more or less, I think I got into them about 2005 or 6.
Yeah. And, okay. So how long ago was that? 13 years?
Something like that.
Yeah. He's only 24 years old. So he would have been 11.
Go to the comments. You'll see it.
11 years old.
Yeah.
Wow. Mature. 12, very mature.
12 years old. Because he had a really young sounding voice, like when they first started. Yeah. And everyone was freaking out.
Yeah.
And he had screaming vocals, he had all of it. And it was nuts. When he was like 12 years old, man. He's 24 and they've been touring for like 10 years.
That's nuts.
But he's fit that fucking mold straight away.
Yeah,
all, like said, they all have girly vocals.
They do. It's just a staple for it. That style. Yeah.
Yeah, but dude, you know who they are. You've heard them before. I put this up once. Yeah. You've heard this before. This is brilliant. Remember it?
Punk goes pop.
Bye 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 by Our Last Night with Cody Carson from Set It Off.
Yep. I'm doing this tonight. You're probably gonna start a fight.
This is a great cover.
Yep. Some of those punk goes pop covers are cool.
Yeah, man. I loved you endlessly when you weren't there for me. So now it's time to leave and make it alone. It ain't no lie.
Johnny's getting the shivers up his spine. That door. Bye.
That sounds more boy band than the boy band.
Yeah.
But it ain't no lie. Great song.
Yeah.
I won't put it on now, but I'll get you to listen to it later, and you tell me if that's... There's a band called Periphery, and they do the cover... actually, you know what? Fuck it. I'll... All right. They do the metal cover one.
Oh, one. Ooh. so far, so good.
And you tell me vocals, musically wise, you tell me what you think they are.
Fuck, such a good track, man.
And these guys do a brilliant cover of it, but I didn't know what. Because when I listen to bands, I don't think, oh, that's metalcore, or that's. I just listen to
it. Just listen to it, and if you like it,
but I know the difference between thrash and heavy metal and all that kind of stuff. Just give it a second, I'm cooking now. But these guys do a lot of stuff like I listened to just now. What's that band called? That
you just played? Last night.
They do some stuff like that. But I think these guys are a bit more heavier. I should have forwarded it.
Relax, man. It's one.
Very soft voice, but he does the screams as well. So... So, do you know what I'm trying to say?
Yeah, yeah.
Like, something different. But when it gets to the middle bit, it goes fucking like...
Yeah. Well, that's typical post-hardcore, you know? Okay.
Like, his voice, the way it is.
According to Wikipedia, what style do you reckon their musical... what do you reckon they've called... described as? Their musical style, what's it described as?
Periphery, or that...
Periphery. I've just looked them up now.
I wouldn't have a clue, man.
Okay, honestly. You don't know? What would you say just by listening to that?
Yeah, well, if Nick said he's got the screaming part after that, very post-hardcore, I guess.
You know what they're called? Wikipedia says their musical style has been described as progressive metal as well as djent.
That was djent.
D-J-E-N-T.
I have no idea what that is.
D-J-E-N-T is a style of progressive metal named for an onomatopoeia for the distinctive high-gain, distorted, palm-muted, low-pitched guitar sound first employed by Meshuggah.
Okay.
And I've heard of Meshuggah.
Yeah, I've heard of Meshuggah. Progressive metal is a fusion genre melding heavy metal and progressive rock.
All right, do me a favor, keep talking, because I'm going to try to find that bit.
Which, hang on, amplified guitar sound of the former with the more experimental cerebral or pseudo-classical compositions of the latter.
Yeah, see, it gets really like...
Dude, what the hell is progressive metal? And it says here, like, the genre emerged till the late 80s, and it wasn't until the 90s when progressive metal achieved commercial success. Dream Theater, Symphony X, Queensryche, Fate's Warning. I've heard of Fate's Warning, Queensryche, and Dream Theater, and Symphony X. I've heard of all these bands. But I would... Dream Theater is progressive sort of metal. But at the same time, it says, dude, additionally, many other thrash and death metal bands start to incorporate elements of aggressive music in their work. Mm. So, like Dream Theater, when I used to hear them, I'd call them just fucking metal.
Just like, metal, yeah. Like,
yeah, but yeah. Progressive, yeah.
Right, counterpart.
And then it's like, well, who isn't progressive? Like, okay. You know how I just said before, power metal, symphonic metal, yeah. Opera metal, all that shit? It's like Nightwish. Right?
Yeah.
One of Finland's biggest fucking bands, and they toured extensively, and they gained international success. They were, like, operatic metal.
Yeah. Yeah, I remember you guys showing me, like, full opera style.
Yeah.
Like,
but they were also symphonic metal as well.
Mm.
And that they had a lot of elements of melodic death metal in, too. Like, European, Scandinavian staple metal.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
So where does it end with these fucking labels? Mm-hmm. Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm. Totally.
A drummer that can actually play the part. Dramatic, kind of... I've never heard of that big djent.
Djent?
Djent.
That sounds sick.
Solid as, man. They nailed it.
See, that's just metal.
Like, yeah, that doesn't sound...
Thrash.
It's not really a post-metal, post-hardcore sort of scream. It's different. It's more of like a metal sort of...
Well, I was going to say, this sounds to me is like a lot metalcore.
Yeah. But then they've also got the cleans. It's like, yeah.
See, okay. What do you think...
cool cover, by the way. It's different. Like, it's...
Dude, these guys nail it. Give it a listen, man. The whole thing through.
Okay, look this way. We were giving shit to Chester Bennington about making a pop album that sounds exactly like everything that's coming out, yeah? And we said our only grievance with it was that it was under the Linkin Park name and not...
If he came out on his own, did solo, I would have gone, that's cool as, man. Like, all because right.
That's what we said. We said, this isn't Linkin Park. If you listen to our first initial reaction, we said, that's wrong. Like,
we can't think of a band that's done that much of a turnaround. Yeah, like, that much of a... Yeah.
Yeah, do you know what I mean? We said, it's cool, but it's not Linkin Park. It's not what... Like, you're alienating all your fans, right? And as an artist, I understand getting frustrated and wanting to do, like, your own thing. Maybe, you know, whether you had obligations to your record label, obligations to your team, whatever it is to do something over and over again, and wanting to break away from it. Like, I get it. But then, at what point... When is it acceptable to make that switch between genres without alienating your people? Or does it really matter what you do? Like, Prince.
Yeah.
Like, you know, I had this conversation. I remember when Prince passed away, me and my mum were talking about him. And I remember saying, at the end of the day, Prince was indeed, like, a true artist to the sense where he never compromised his musical... vision for what's it called, like, society, social restrictions. He didn't give a fuck.
No, he did what he wanted.
He did what he wanted. Like, does that make sense?
Mm-hmm.
Right? With me, what pisses me off is when artists, modern artists, or like popular, what you determine popular, because popular music is what is trending. Mm. Does that make sense? Like, when you make pop now is different to pop 50 years ago or 30 years ago, because it's whatever trends. Like, dude, Michael Jackson took pop to another level because he had that urban crossover and he combined urban elements with soul elements and dance elements and made his sound. And that became... Jackson was the king of pop.
That's why they call him the king of pop. Yeah.
He was the king of pop. But, dude, in the 50s and 60s, Elvis was the king of pop.
Yeah.
And the Beatles were the king of pop because that's what was out in the 50s and 60s. Yeah. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
You listen to pop now...
Nick Carter's the king of pop.
Nick Carter's dead.
Seriously. OD'd somewhere.
Yeah. Like, you listen to pop now and it's mostly urban music. Like, as in elements of, like, hip-hop and, like, all that shit. And to go even further than that, they all steal the 808 sounds from the South. Like, the...
Yeah.
Like, every beat for the last fucking 10 years has just been...
just works.
Over and over and over again. So that becomes a new element of pop. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
And then you got trap artists sitting around like, man, we've had that fucking album out for like 20 years. Like, now you're catching on to it? Like, it's shit.
Mm.
I used to, you know what got me? I finally put Nelly Grills on my iPod.
Couldn't rob the jewelry store.
Yeah, dude, I've never listened to Nelly Grills in its original form. I've always just had a chopped and screwed version of it that I've played over and over again.
Which is pretty cool.
I'd rob the jewelry store and make me a grill. Like, I've only been listening to that for like 10 years. So now the original version sounds really weird to me, right? But I remember when I first started listening to Chopped and Screwed, like 2005, 6, it was around that era. When I first got into Chopped and Screwed, which has been around since the late 80s, right, in Texas, I remember all these tracks came out on the radio that started incorporating Chopped and Screwed elements, like pitch down vocals.
You're like, hang on a second, wait. Yeah.
And I think it was it Glamorous by Fergie?
Glamorous.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. At the end of it, Ludacris.
Go, I know you want to sing it. Do it.
No, I can't think of the actual words she says. So I'm not going to do it. The flossy, flossy.
If you remember Ludacris.
I can see him in his face. He's like, I'm going to say it.
I remember when that song came out, right? I didn't have a bar of it, like, at the start.
Which, sorry?
Glamorous.
Oh, Glamorous, yeah.
Yeah.
Flossy, Flossy.
Yeah. Flossy, Flossy.
I remember a mate of mine called me up and said, oh, there's a track on the radio that sounds like Chopped and Screwed shit that you always play. I'm like, really? What track? Oh, some track by Fergie. I'm like, huh? And then I played it.
Say what?
I played it, and I listened to the whole track. Like, it serves its purpose. It's a pop track, like, whatever it is, right? And I waited for the whole track to hear, like,
Chopped and Screwed
thing, and there was literally, like, a two-second sample of, like, Ludacris's verse or something. He's like, think you're broke ass home.
Yeah.
Like, is that the Chopped and Screwed thing? Like, the
That's not chopped and screwed.
One of a second?
Yeah, yeah.
Dude, the chopped and screwed, it was like... Like, I remember when Dim, I'd go to his place and put on chopped and screwed, and you think, whoa. It took you a little bit to get used to.
Yeah.
Like, if you've never heard it before...
Had to down, like, a bottle, down a bottle of codeine to make
holy
it.
Holy shit. Well,
no,
because... No. We listened to it straight, man. Like, yeah. There was a, but it's just different, so different. It sounded cool, though. I was like, holy shit, man, this is...
It's because, good. For me...
Probably would have enjoyed it more, being off your nut on codeine, maybe.
Not really.
Just whoa.
Why?
I don't know.
Hang on. March and Step. There was a track, because I remember, like, there was a... like, okay, I don't know if you listen to Chopped and Screwed, but this is, like, a standard staple Paul Wall track that's Chopped and Screwed, right? Because this album came out with two versions, the Chopped and Screwed version and the original.
It's like Doom.
Doom rap.
Doom rap. You can imagine just going...
This is a hot remix.
Tony needs codeine.
Or a big blunt.
Never in the room, the only vault, Mort.
Now, this is the original, right? There's a difference.
They shouldn't have done this right here.
Yeah.
Totally different, right?
Completely. Chalk and cheese. The third time.
Now, the thing with me is, like, I used to listen to Chopped and Screwed because it adds, like, another technical element to the music. Because what you can get away with Chopped and Screwed is you add emphasis to certain words and phrases. Like, you know, you could have a verse, chop the verse down to, like, 12 bars and only use one line and just repeat it twice.
Mm-hmm.
And just add it. It's just listening to something in a totally another sense. Like, it's
mm-hmm.
weird,
mm.
right? And that's entirely... That style's been around. Like I said, DJ Screw created it in, like, late 80s, whatever, and it was part of the big codeine, purple mix and fucking Texas shit. And then, like, yeah, my mate calls me up because Fergie added it to, like, the element. I'm like, where? It's like one word. Like, what are you talking about?
It wasn't Thomas Green. It just got slowed down.
Yeah.
For a second.
Just for a second.
His voice, yeah.
Yeah.
Luda!
Yeah.